everybody's doing well. I want to thank you for coming this morning. It may be hard for you to believe, but I have looked forward to the opportunity to address the media for some time. I certainly do not take any pleasure in what has brought us together today. In fact, I regret more than anyone will ever know what happened earlier this year. I am embarrassed. My irresponsible action caused a lot of pain for a number of people. It is only by the grace of God and the unwavering love of my wife, brothers, sons, parents, and many other family members and friends across the country that I stand before you today at peace with the past and looking forward to the future. Shortly, I will stand before a judge and plead guilty to unlawfully obtaining and possessing prescription drugs for non-medical purposes. I accept full responsibility for what happened. There are no excuses. I did it, and I am sorry. And now I must face the consequences. For 115 days, I willingly subjected myself to a demanding and rigorous drug recovery and rehabilitation center at what is without question the finest facility of its kind, Cirque Lodge in Sundance, Utah. Even though the setting was beautiful, this was no vacation. The program was intense and the most challenging thing I've ever done in my life. The people were tremendous, and they created a place of peace, hope, and recovery. I entered Cirque Lodge a broken man, recognizing I could lose everything that I treasured in life. Trina and I are very pleased that Gary Fisher, the director of operation at Cirque Lodge, is with us here today. Thank you, Gary. I can say without hesitation, Gary and his team not only helped me turn my life around, but saved my life. And in doing so, I am happier than I've been in many, many years. But I am not naive. I am on a journey for life. Failure is not an option. I have experienced firsthand the powerful grip prescription drug abuse and addiction can have on a person, and I am committed to breaking the awful cycle of addiction that has harmed my family. I don't want my three sons, Hunter, Spencer, Parker, or my nieces and nephews to ever experience the heartache of addiction. Prescription drug abuse is an epidemic in our country. If you recognize you have a problem, don't wait to ask for help. There is hope. You can change course and regain control of your life. I now have a lifelong commitment to self-awareness, spiritual growth, and recovery. I have my family, and I have my future. Life is good. Speaking of family, I want to thank my beautiful wife, Trina, for her love, support, and strength she has displayed during these trying times. There's no better wife in the world. She does not deserve what she has endured. I have caused her much pain. She has been there for me and with me. My love for her is uncompromised. She is my rock and she is my angel. I am thankful and I am grateful to have her as my partner and my best friend. I love you, I'm proud of you, and I will forever be by your side. As for my three boys, they mean the world to me. They inspire me to be better. They are great kids. I want to be the father they deserve. My family has come second to my career for many years. See, coaching basketball is what I do. It's not who I am. From this point forward, my family is my first priority. I have a renewed appreciation for what is really important in life. I treasure my parents, my brothers, my nieces, my nephews. I apologize to each of you, and I'm so thankful for your continuous support to love me even when I was not lovable. I must say, however, I caused a lot of pain, and I owe the people of Oklahoma, especially the youth in this state, an apology for being a poor example. I also want to apologize to the sport of college basketball for the negative publicity this has brought to the game. Again, I'm deeply, deeply sorry. I know I have a lot to prove to regain your confidence and restore your faith in me. I am ready, and with God's help and support of my family and friends, I believe I can earn your trust again. My heart was warmed by the overwhelming support I received from fellow coaches across the country. The letters, the prayers, the words of encouragement lifted my spirit and fueled my recovery. Your expressions of kindness turned hopelessness into hope. To me, the Oklahoma State fans who called and wrote, thank you very much. It meant a lot to me and my family. OSU will always have a special place in my heart. I would love to coach again at some point. I don't know when, but I do know as tough as this experience has been for me, I have emerged a better person, stronger yet humbled, and I am confident I will be a better coach when and if appropriate opportunity arises. Lastly, I do not blame anybody. This was my mistake. I am now at peace with the past, and I'm committed to live in the present and look forward to building a bright future with my wonderful family. I am now pleased to introduce my good friend, Gary Fisher.
Well, good morning, everybody. My name is Gary Fisher, and I am the director of the Cirque Lodge in Sundance, Utah. I've been in charge of the facility in Sundance for the past 10 years. The Cirque Lodge is a 16-bed adult residential treatment facility. We are licensed by the state of Utah, and we are accredited by the Joint Commission for the Accreditation of Healthcare Organizations, JCAHO. We combine traditional cognitive therapies with a daily experiential session in what is probably the most spiritual setting imaginable. We have an experienced and educated staff, and it is the finest treatment resource, we believe, in America. While it is typically our policy to refrain from commenting on clients, we believe this case merits that we step outside that policy and make a public statement. Sean, from the beginning, has understood the gravity of his situation. From the moment he got on the plane to come to treatment, his determination and drive to overcome his addiction was self-evident. The adult substance abuse treatment program at Cirque Lodge is rigorous, thorough, and quite frankly, it's difficult. Sean completed every assignment, he attended every group, and as his recovery progressed, he became a leader and a mentor to those in our resident community. He participated in our community service program, speaking to our local schools, sharing his experience, strength, and hope. He was open and honest with the kids, connecting with them on a very personal level. If he was a good communicator before, he is a better one today. Never did he shirk a duty or deny a request to talk about the destruction of drugs or the hope of recovery to our at-risk youth. Never, I repeat, never have we had a speaker as effective as Sean. From our first conversation, Sean has been remorseful for his actions. His concern has always been for Trina, his children, and quite frankly, for your community. He was, of course, afraid of the embarrassment that he had caused them and that he had caused all of you. But mainly, it has been about him putting an end to the generational addiction problems that has plagued his family and shining a light on the malady that plagues our country. Most impressively was that I never saw Sean waste 1 minute feeling sorry for himself. His recovery has been about regaining and restoring the principles of his life and then practicing those principles in all of his affairs. I have literally seen thousands of clients enter treatment in my behavioral health career, and I have seen no one work harder in treatment than Sean Sutton. If you have any questions about the lodge or about treatment, I'm happy to take some questions.
At this point, I'll take some questions, but please understand that the investigation is ongoing. Even though my part is done, there's still an ongoing investigation that I'm cooperating with, and there's certain questions regarding the investigation that they have asked me not to speak on. So I hope you understand.
What effects did your addiction have on your basketball coaching career?
None.
Sean, what was it that caused you to fall into the prescription drugs?
Well, I'd been prescribed prescription pain medicine in the past, mainly for lower back pain and migraine headaches, and took them as directed. And at some point in the last year and a half, I crossed the line and became dependent on them. And addiction is a horrible thing. You know, it is powerful. It gets a hold of you, and you feel like there's no way out. And there's not one person that can do it on their own. That I do know. I've tried and I failed miserably. But you can regain control of your life and you can recover if you do the things that the program teaches you to do. And that is attend meetings, call your sponsor, read treatment books, pray, reach out to your support group. If you do those things, you have 100% chance of recovering from this disease.
Sounds like you hope to use this as sort of an educational opportunity for others to have some of the problems about the dangers.
Well, as I said in my statement, this is a huge epidemic right now in this country. And there's a lot of kids traveling down the road of addiction. And research shows kids between 18 and 25 are involved heavily in prescription drugs. And if I can make a difference in a young man's life or a young woman's life, I want to be there for them. I don't want them to fall into the trap and make the mistakes that I've made with my life.
Any plans to educate others about the experience you went through?
Sure, I'd love to. You know, I had a chance when I was in CERC to go out and speak to five or six schools. I found the experience very rewarding, very educational, and I think it helped the kids a lot to understand the dangers of prescription medicine.
Sean, back in August, you went through a program but had a relapse. What's different about this program that you're confident that won't happen again?
That's a really good question. And one of the things that I didn't learn the first time I went to treatment is I did not surrender myself to completely give myself to the program. I kept thinking because of pride and my stubborn nature that I could fix the problem on my own. And obviously I was wrong. And sometimes it takes more than one time to be able to get it right.
Your father has battled addiction. What has he done to help you do this ordeal right here? And what have Big 12 coaches, maybe any other coaches run to this particular problem, what have they done to help you through the situation?
Well, my father has been very supportive through all this. He understands addiction as well as the rest of my family. It's not fun. It's not easy. But, you know, we've chosen this as an opportunity to reach out and help others. The coaches across the country, as I've mentioned, have been spectacular. Many, many of the Big 12 coaches have reached out and given me great support. So they were all real class acts.
Sean, obviously, you're still very young. You talk about coaching again somewhere down the future. Is there a timeline that you kind of have that in your mind, or you just kind of take it day by day?
You know, at this point, I'm not going to let it consume me. The most important thing right now is my family and making a strong recovery. You know, I hope the opportunity will be there based off what I've heard from fellow coaches. You know, I think in time I will go back to coaching. And because of the experiences that I've had, I think I'll be a much better basketball coach.
Sean, for your long-term mental health, do you need to coach?
You know, I love basketball, and I always have. By the time I was 5 years old, I already developed a great passion for the game, and I've been around it all of my life except the past 2 years. And I got to admit that I've struggled with not being involved in a team because, you know, since I was, I guess I started playing organized basketball in the first grade, until I was 38 when I resigned at Oklahoma State, I've always been involved. And, you know, I lost kind of track of myself. I made the statement. I got consumed with, you know, I thought that's what I was. I was a basketball coach. But really, that's what I do. It's not the person that I am. And, you know, I hope it happens, Jimmy. I really do. I think it would be good for me. But at the same time, I'm at peace with where I stand today.
How much, Sean, have you, during this time of treatment and everything, how much did you find yourself looking back over your 2 years as head coach and kind of replaying the things, the good and the bad?
Well, I think when you become a head coach, it's a learning process. You know, there's some things and some mistakes that I made that I could have handled differently. But at the time, I was still relatively new in that position. And so, you know, I think I tried to do the best with the situation that I was in at the time.
Sean, give us an idea of what your treatment was like, how difficult it was at any point, and was there a point where you felt like you really made a breakthrough?
I did. You know, when I walked through the doors, you know, I was a broken man. My spirit was crushed. It was very hard on myself, and it's something that I'm still working on today. The ability to go back at some point and learn to forgive myself. But, you know, I was committed to doing the work. I made the decision, I don't want to live like this anymore. This is no fun. This is not fair to my family. And I'm better than this. And the hours at Cirque Lodge are demanding. You know, you basically start from 8 in the morning and you finish about 9:45 at night. And it's grueling, but it gets you to really get to the core of what causes addiction in your life. And it makes you get in touch with your feelings. And you know, I can't say enough about Gary, my counselor at Cirque Lodge, the people. There's no place better that treats chemical dependency. Lowest point, I would say at the FedEx when the officers pulled up. It was a pretty low point.
Sean, is it difficult or therapeutic for you to sit up there and spill your guts like that?
It's therapeutic. You know, one of the benefits that I have is there are no secrets with me. It's out in the open. You know, my problem is well known about, and I think, you know, I'm in a better position to help people because of it. And I think people have seen the struggles that my family has gone through, and I hope that we can get in position to make a difference in people's lives by helping them through this terrible, terrible thing.
At what point did you decide to come here and speak about this?
Oh, during treatment. Gary and I spoke about this many, many times, all the way back into March, and this was always something that I had planned for, something I wanted to do and was committed to doing.
Sean, being a coach, we talked about it at the treatment center, you're going out and speaking to kids and stuff. Was that also therapeutic for you to be able to go out and do that?
It was. And, you know, I got the opportunity to go to 5 or 6 schools and visit with the students. It was a rewarding experience for me. I think it was very beneficial to them.
When was it that you went to the Cirque Lodge?
I checked in February 18th.
Sean, do you feel like being away from basketball may have ultimately accelerated the addiction to play a part in the addiction?
I do. You know, idle time is no good for anybody. And when you're not doing things productively every day, you don't feel good about yourself. And I felt lost for the first time in my life. Other than my kids and my wife, I didn't have anything to really motivate me and get me to look forward to the day. And, I, you know, as a person that's been very driven throughout their life, you know, I was lost.
What's going to motivate you now?
My wife and my kids, my family, that I don't want them to ever experience the heartache of addiction. 115.
Any contact with family?
Believe me, I count it.
Was there any contact with family while you were in, or you just had to wait to get out before you could see them?
Oh, no. You know, they run they have a great family program up there, and they want to embrace all the family, because this is a family disease. Addiction affects everybody in your family. So my 3 boys came up. They went through sessions. It was great education for them. Trina came up several times, and my parents and my brothers came up and spent 5 days and went through the family program. And even though that they knew a lot about addiction, they learned a lot more.
Sean, you mentioned that every day, probably now for the rest of your life, you're going to be battling this. What is it like on a daily basis for you, the addiction? Are there craves? What do you go through? And if yes, there are the craves, how do you get over that?
Well, it's, you know, it's a fight every day. For anybody that's ever been dependent on a chemical, it's never as easy as just flipping a switch and it's over with. It's a battle every day. And you have to make a commitment to do your program every day. And if you don't and you miss enough days, eventually it's going to get a hold of you again. And, you know, as I said earlier, you know, that's going to meetings. That's reaching out to your support group. That's visiting with your sponsor. That's visiting with people like Gary that are in my support group to keep me on track and doing the right thing. And then just keeping my focus about what's really important and where I want to be.
How important do you think it's going to be for you to get back into basketball just to provide that you can step away from that and be more involved with that?
You know, I think it would be very helpful. But that's not something that I'm concerned about today.
You may not be able to say a whole lot about this, but you know, you mentioned going to court this afternoon.
You know, I don't know. It'll be up to the judge. As I said, you know, I did it. I made a mistake. I've apologized for that. And I'll accept the consequences of whatever he decides. Thank you for coming, and appreciate everybody showing up.